everybody doing? Good. If you're alive this morning, just wave a hand. Say, I'm alive. I'm alive. Thank God I'm alive. Welcome to Genesis. Glad you are here. It is so good that the weather broke for us again. I think that this shows us that God is with us. He wants us to worship, and today's a great day to do it. So my name is Jay, and we welcome you here. Also, we have Gwen and Tom and Bill with us, and Kevin over here, and Dan, too. So we're glad to be here with you. A couple quick things real fast as we get ready to go. We can get you some song sheets. If you don't have any, we'd love for you to be able to sing along with us today and worship. And so if you would like a song sheet, if you raise your hand, somebody can come and pass you out a song sheet. Also, we can text you a digital copy of the song sheet, which is really cool. You can put it on your phone, and then later you can look at it and meditate on the words, sing it to your dog at home or to whoever didn't make it to church today, and they'll love that. Text SONG to 231-412-2866. Again, text SONG to 231-412-2866, and we'll get those lyrics right out to you right now. So that's in real time. Also, even though we're outside, we're still required to do the 6-foot social distancing, so we want to encourage you to do that, and also take a minute to spread out if you can. If you are unable to register for the service, we do encourage you to do that. We just want to make sure that we are helping and being able to pray for you and find out your needs and stay in contact with you as well. So if you would, please just text your name and your email to Genesis to that same number, and then we'll take care of that to you. So check out the phone number and just text that to us, your name and your email, and we'll get to you. Also ask that you wear a mask when you're mingling about a little bit just to keep people safe and feeling good. Everybody good with that? Awesome. Would you do me a favor and just stand this morning? We're going to sing some songs. They're relatively easy. If you don't know them, just check out the lyrics. If you want to sing them, go for it. If you sing out a tune, don't worry about it. Sing it at the top of your lungs and everything's going to be fun. Sound good? All right, here we go. If y'all want to put your hands together, if you're not holding lyrics, you can too. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All you've done, Lord. How many think God is great this morning? How many have experienced His amazing love? His unfailing forgiveness? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes this orphan son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Sing it out, saints. You would take my place, that you would be
cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done. Something out together this morning as a proclamation. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Sing it out. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
All right, you guys can take a seat. Welcome, everybody, to Genesis Church gathered outside at the waterfront today. My name is Johnny Whitcomb. I am the student's pastor here, and I'm just so thankful that you guys all came out today. You know, I woke up this morning. It was kind of misty out and cold, and I think this is the season of lost hoodies and light jackets because you put them on when you leave the house, and then halfway through whatever you're doing throughout the day, you go, I don't need this on. So you take it off and put it someplace and leave it there. So just make sure that as you leave today that you take all the hoodies and jackets and sweaters that you brought with you home. But welcome to Genesis Church today. If you're new here, a special welcome to you too. Especially if you want to text us, we figure that's the most informal, fastest way to get to know somebody is just shoot them a text. And so you can text us at text Genesis 231-412-2866. Say hello, say where you're from, and we'd love to connect with you after service. We have a welcome table now back in the back. We've been doing this outside service for a couple weeks now. We're getting pretty good at it. We brought a ladder to put that sign up and stuff, so we're really hitting our stride with this outdoor thing. But come to the welcome table. We'd love to connect with you there. And here at Genesis Church, we have some values that we like to live out. One of those is outward focus. We're not just here for ourselves. We're here for other people. We're here from the people that, you know, we can't see around us, people across the globe. And so that's why I want to share with you our one thing today, which is the Orphan Helpers tailgate. That's coming up the September 11th. That's a Friday night, and it's a tailgate at the Genesis Center. So you want to come through, and we're raising money to support Orphan Helpers, which is an awesome organization that provides for the needs and shares the gospel with people who are incarcerated in South America. And so make sure that you come to that tailgate. It runs from 5 to 7. It's a really, really great thing. Bring your whole family and show up for that. So put it in your calendars. You can text tailgate to Genesis to get more information on that as well. But that's our one thing for today, the Orphan Helpers tailgate fundraiser happening the 11th of September. So at this time, I think we're going to have a prayer.
We're actually going to worship a little bit.
Worship a little bit more.
Yeah. Let's stand up again, and we'll pray, we'll worship, we'll sing, and we'll enjoy the presence of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Let's turn our hearts to the Lord today.
so good, God. Learned the every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever pray. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Thank you.
We can meet outside like this. We've done this in the past, but it's a little special this year because it's really helping us, I think, be able to, in this time of coronavirus and all this stuff. So it's been really wonderful. And I was thinking, we're studying the Sermon on the Mount, and the Sermon on the Mount starts with, says, "Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them." And I just think that's kind of interesting. We're studying the Sermon on the Mount. We're out here, and we're being taught by Jesus' same words outside in nature, enjoying what he created. So, but as we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, I've been thinking, some of these teachings are kind of hard. And Scott is going to talk today about loving your neighbor, which is a tough thing. Or not loving your neighbor, loving your enemy, even. Which is quite a bit different. That's a very hard teaching, and a lot of these teachings are hard. And I think one of the key things is that we need to ask God for help, because if we try to conform ourselves to these teachings by our own will, we can't do that. So we really value prayer here at Genesis, and we think that that's part of the key to being able to follow Jesus is praying. So would you join me now as we pray? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We thank you, God, and we praise you because you are all-powerful, always present, and all-knowing. We praise you because you are perfectly just and yet also merciful. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. We thank you that you know what is best. We ask that you conform our desires to the things that you desire. Carry out your will in our lives and not ours. Help us to trust that you know best and rejoice in this fact. Give us today our daily bread. We thank you for providing for us and taking care of all of our needs, no matter what the circumstances. As your word says, give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of the God, my God. God, humble our hearts and help us to see ourselves as we truly are. You know specifically what each of us needs at each specific time in our life, and we ask that you provide for us as you have faithfully done throughout generations. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We ask that you forgive us our sins. We repent for pride in our hearts and for not acting justly with the people around us. We repent for not loving you with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and for not loving other people in the same way that we love ourselves. Help us to extend the same grace that you generously give to us to those around us. And not only to the people who treat us well, but as we're going to study today, also to those who we disagree with or those who treat us poorly. Give us a heart for others that is not based on what we get out of the relationship. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. God, we pray that you will give us the power to do what is right. Keep us from falling into sin and temptation, and give us strength to resist the devil and his path of destruction. We thank you and we praise you, and we ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to take just a couple minutes to kind of greet each other and have a little bit of community time, but remember, take some distance. I'm good at that. I'm a natural social distancer. I always have been. So keep 6 feet, kind of keep a little space and put your mask on, but go ahead and talk to each other. Thanks. Thank you.
All right, if you can find a seat, that would be fantastic. As you're finding your seat, I also want to encourage you to find your place in the Bible in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. Matthew 5, 43. As you're finding that, I want to take you back to a time in my life and tell you a true story, a story that I'm entitling The Perfect Christmas. We were visiting my parents in Illinois, and it was a beautiful, snowy Christmas Eve afternoon. We were traveling from their house a couple of miles across town to my grandparents. It was literally over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house we go, kind of a moment. And the kids were in the back seat, Matthew and Nathan, ages 6 and 3, and our little baby girl, Grace, was just a couple of months old in her car seat right behind her mom. And the snow was still falling, and there were some Christmas carols on the radio, and bam, bam, bam. All of a sudden, there were these explosions on the side of our car. Like, what happened? And it was that scary. And I realized in a kind of a quick moment that we'd been hit by some snowballs thrown like 90-mile-an-hour fastballs, and they exploded on the windows right next to my wife and our little baby girl. After my heart started up again, and I was driving down the road, I just started getting upset. I don't get angry very easily at all, but I was upset. Man, I mean, I've thrown some snowballs in my lifetime, let's just confess, but these were like hard-packed ice, and I started grumbling. Like, I can't believe they would do that. I mean, wow, they could damage the car. The windows could have broken. You guys could have been hurt. This is ridiculous. And I was just kind of going on. I got about a quarter of a mile down the road, and I started saying, you know, I should go back and teach those kids a lesson. My kinder, gentler, smarter wife said, yeah, you should. And that's all it took. So I wheeled around, and I went back. And I tried to find the house that I saw the people out of the corner of my eye in the front yard, and there they were. I pulled into the end of their driveway. It was still filled with snow. I got out of the car, and I started marching my way up the driveway. Now, a little science lesson timeout. You ever noticed that things that are far away look a lot smaller than they really are? I was moving my way up the driveway and suddenly realized there's three guys standing here, and they're not kids. They're much bigger than me. There was a teenage boy who was just huge, and right next to him was his dad. Dad was easily 6'7", 300 pounds. And right next to him was Grandpa, big guy from the same stock. He had a cane in one hand and a snowball in the other hand, I'm not kidding, that he sheepishly dropped as I came walking up. And I suddenly realized as I was getting closer, I had absolutely no plan whatsoever of what was going to happen next. They're much bigger than I am. The only thing I've got is my mouth. So I came marching up and I went, you know, if I were really, really big, I would teach you guys a lesson. But since I'm really, really small, I can't. And there was this long pause, and they didn't know what to think, and I kind of grinned just a little bit to break the ice, and whew, they sighed. And I said, you know, seriously, guys, somebody could get hurt, and I got kids in the car and my family, and I kind of let it all out, and they sort of apologized. And I got back in the car and drove the rest of the way to Grandma and Grandpa's house, a little bit of release there, dramatically told the story to the whole family, of course, when we got there. And then we moved on to the perfect Christmas, right? The story actually doesn't end there, but I'm going to leave it there for just a little bit and come back to the second chapter a little bit later. What I want to do is look at the passage in Matthew chapter 5 to see, is that the way Jesus instructs us to handle things when somebody does something mean, hateful, or harmful to you? I did what my gut said. I did what felt right. I did the world's method. And to be honest, it seems quite reasonable, doesn't it? It seems reasonable. And yet Jesus teaches us to do something different. When faced with opposition, when faced with hatred, he calls us to love beyond reason. Beyond reason. To love the gospel. To love people with grace and mercy. Our text in Matthew 5:43 says this: you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus interjected himself in my story and flipped the script. And he said, Scott, the way you were going about it is not the way I would go about it or the way I want my followers to go about it. He turned it upside down. He says, instead of responding with anger, you need to love people and love them beyond what is reasonable. So to fulfill this high calling, I want to kind of answer three questions. First of all, the who. Who are my enemies? I'm going to spend most of my time on the why, to convince you why you should do this. And then we'll spend a little time on the practical stuff. Okay, how do you actually go about it? Who is my enemy? Now, to be honest with you, if you ask me, hey, Scott, who's your enemy? I don't have enemies. Everybody likes me, and I like everybody, right? But if we dig a little deeper, we'll discover that's not the case. The original context of this, Jesus was preparing his followers for persecution. People, the world didn't like, the Roman world especially, did not like, and the Jewish people did not like Christ followers and their teachings. And they were persecuted. They were hated. They were even killed. And Jesus is preparing them and says, when you're persecuted, when people hate you because you're a Christian, respond with love. Now, that's real and relevant in many places around the world right now. There are people suffering for the faith. And this passage is powerful. For us here in the U.S., to be honest, we've not faced much persecution. We've enjoyed religious freedom, and I'm grateful for that. But can I just tell you, I'm not a prophet, but it's on the horizon, folks. A very near horizon. And so I think it's going to get harder to live out the gospel and to claim the name of Jesus Christ even in our land. And so let these words form a foundation right now for something that might be 5 years from now or 20 years from now, I don't know, to what will you do if it's just straight out persecution because of your faith. But I want to spend a little more time on some immediate application. Who is my enemy? Simple answer. Anyone with whom you have animosity. Anyone with whom you have animosity. Someone who has harmed you in word or in deed. Maybe there's hard feelings between the two of you, or harsh words have been spoken, or there's just a bad experience and you'd rather avoid them, let alone deal with them in love. Do you think there's any animosity going on in our world right now? Oh my. Just think of the differences between liberal Democrats and MAGA hat Republicans. Think of the animosity between racist cops and race rioters, the rich 1%, the unemployed poor. Search your heart for a second and ask yourself, how do you feel about illegal immigrants, ex-spouses, noisy neighbors? Apparently Josh doesn't get along with his neighbors really well. That's kind of what I took from the love your neighbors is the hard thing. I'm kidding. How do you feel about Muslims, business rivals, that girl who was hitting on your boyfriend, that guy who took your spot on the sports team, the other kid in class who's the favorite of the teacher? See, if we dig long enough, we discover we've got some hard feelings with some people. And if you've been hating or fighting or maybe just even avoiding, the world would say that's reasonable. That's reasonable. Just avoid all that or give it back to them. And Jesus says no. Love beyond reason. So can you identify some people right now in your life that you would just as soon avoid, if not give something back to in a harsh way? Keep that in mind. That's the who. Why? Why choose love? I'm going to give you two reasons. The first is this, because your Father, your Heavenly Father, if you're a Christ follower, established love as a family trait. He established love as probably the most defining family trait of the Christian family. Have you ever discovered how families have their own unique characteristics and traits, right? Some families are really loud, and some talk very quietly and softly. Some families all vote a certain way, or we always buy Fords in our family, and the first one that doesn't, whoo, boy, they're an outcast. Some families eat pickles with pizza. I'm married into that. Seriously. The first time I had pizza with my wife's family when we were dating, I'm like, what is this? They brought out pickles? Guess who's the first one to go get the pickles now? these many years later. It's become a family trait. Jesus says this is the family trait. Verse 44, I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Why? That you may be children of your Father in heaven. If you're a child of God, then you should be loving your enemies. Like God, he causes his sun, S-U-N, to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. It's a family trait. Every day, the sun is shining, even if it's behind the clouds, or it's raining. A day like today, it's doing both. And God's saying, that's my love. I'm sending what it takes to live life and nourish. And I do it generously, and I do it regularly, and I do it consistently, and I do it for my children, and I do it for people who hate me, or people who don't even know I exist. That's God. Loving people who don't love him back. So the question is, if you're part of God's family, will you do that as well? Will you love the unlovable and those that even hate you? Now, these teachings in the Sermon on the Mount are not just moralistic, good teachings that everybody ought to live out. They're really meant for Christ followers. Josh mentioned that in the Sermon on the Mount, that people came to him, sat out on this mountain, and says his disciples, he came to him, and he taught them. They basically said, teach us to be like you. Teach us to follow. Teach us to be like the Heavenly Father. And so Jesus said, okay, you really want to hear this? I'll tell you. To be my follower, to be part of the family, is these distinguishing marks of loving people beyond reason. And he mentions a couple kinds of people. Like in this text, tax collectors came up. Remember tax collectors? They are despised in the New Testament world. They're cheats. They steal from people. And we talked a couple months ago about the story of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. Nobody liked Zacchaeus. But Jesus said, Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your house and I'm going to eat with you. He loved Zacchaeus beyond reason, so much it shocked everybody. Look at Jesus on the cross fulfilling these words that he taught us. He's stretched out on the cross and he says, Father, family trait here, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. He prayed for his persecutors. What does he tell us to do in this passage? Pray for our persecutors. Isn't it wonderful that Jesus never calls us to do something he wasn't willing to do? So there's Jesus on the cross, loving. I believe that the test of being in the family of God is love. That's the prime test. They'll know we're Christians by our love. And the test of love is not how you treat the saints, but how you treat the sinners, especially those who sin against you. Let me say that again. The test of love is not how you relate to saints, but to sinners, especially those who sin against you. That's the measurement of whether you're a loving person or not. I love my wife, and I love my kids, and I love my dog, and I can love you, and that's all great, but you give me someone that's hard to love, and that'll tell you whether I'm a Christian or not. So if you're not a Christ follower, then do what's reasonable. Get back at them. Grumble all you want. Have the same attitude I had on that Christmas Eve. That's reasonable. But if you're a Christ follower, he calls us to do something more than that. It's what I call the more than principle. Verse 46. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even tax collectors doing that? If you're only greeting your friends, so what? Pagans do that. Christians, we should be doing more than the world. And I got to be honest with you, sometimes we do, and historically the church has. But then there's some times where, honestly, we're put to shame by just the average person who doesn't know Christ. Are we really doing more than? Or are we doing about the same? Personal question, are you doing more than an unbeliever in terms of love? If so, is it obvious? So we love not just to be different, but to make a difference. And only love will change. Only love will transform relationships. You know, I'm thinking about the riots that go on and those kinds of things that are happening right now. And I'm kind of a law and order guy. And so, you know, my first instinct is, you know, let's calm everything down. And that's good. And that's fine. And that's right. But rules do not change people. Rules are good. Laws are good. They constrain and restrain people. They restrain us from sin, but they don't change our hearts whatsoever. We could bring in the National Guard. We could calm everything down. And that might be the best thing to do. But that doesn't change the underlying situation whatsoever. Something has to happen where we begin to connect with one another in our culture in love. Only love will change what's going on. understanding and relating. You can apply that in all kinds of situations. The change has to start with us. C.S. Lewis was criticized by somebody, by a critic, about his words regarding the Sermon on the Mount. And somebody said that Lewis didn't care for the Sermon on the Mount. And Lewis said, "You're right, I don't care for it. If you mean care for it, meaning I like it, I don't like it. Because it's like a sledgehammer to the face. Jesus just, boom, hits you with these hard teachings. And nobody should like that. But it's still very good and important." So how do you go about loving your enemy? And why does it change things? I want you to understand that, first of all, when I say love them because it brings change, I don't mean to them. I mean, it may. I mean to the situation and relationship, and I mean most of all to you. Lewis says, when you are behaving as if you loved someone, in other words, just start with the behavior even if you don't feel it. When you're behaving as you loved someone, you will presently come to love him. The feelings follow the action. The worldly man treats certain people kindly because he likes them. The Christian, trying to treat everyone kindly, finds himself liking more and more people as he goes, including people he could not even have imagined himself liking at the beginning. So the world says, get even with your enemy. Some people in the world and many Christians go, no, that's not right. Just let it go. Right? We've been there. I'm just going to let it go. I'm here to tell you this morning, that's not good enough. Jesus says, don't just let it go. He says, change it with love. Act. I'm going to be honest with you. I end up here all the time. Just let it go. Not going to get mad back. Doing a really good thing. And Jesus says, halfway. Come on. Come on. What's the family trait? Love. Love your enemy with action. So, who is my enemy? Anyone with whom there's animosity. Why choose love? Because our Heavenly Father does, and it's the only thing that's going to bring change into relationships. And before we discuss the how, I want to go back now to my Christmas story. So we finished up Christmas at my grandparents'. It was now late evening, early night. We got back in the car. Kids were quiet in the back. We worked our way back, same route toward home, and we were starting to approach the place of the snowball incident. And all of a sudden, feelings started coming back up in me, right? Not the happy Christmas feelings of an hour prior, the snowball feelings of much earlier. And I started kind of grumbling out loud, going, yeah, I wonder if those guys are still out there. You know, they're probably inside now, you know, finishing up their, you know what I ought to do? I ought to pull over, make some snowballs, and throw them against that big picture window in the front of their house and see what they think of that with big explosions on their picture. I'm saying this out loud to Tammy. And all of a sudden, in the back of the car, my 6-year-old son says, Dad, aren't you supposed to love your enemies? Do good to those who hate you? Bless those who curse you? And pray for those who mistreat you? Literally quoted that. 6 years old! You see, when we were traveling from Michigan to Illinois, we made the mistake, I mean, we did the really smart parenting thing, of putting these Christian songs, these scriptures to songs, on all the way to Illinois. And he memorized it that fast. And he repeated it back to me at that moment. See, I had an idea of what the script ought to say. Get back. Get even. Even if I wasn't going to probably do anything. Don't worry, I've matured a lot since then. But, boy, I wanted to, and I was rehearsing it in my mind at least. And my son said, that's not the script. That's not the Jesus script. And I was humbled, and I was convicted. And all of a sudden, these angry thoughts and feelings I had, these visions of shards of glass flying, I had to do something different. So what do? I began even then to like, okay, I'm going to pray for these people. I'm going to bless these people. So how do you flip the script? Let's talk about that. Our text gives us some short pointers, not a lot of detail. Pray, number one, right? Changes you, changes them. Gives you the power to live differently. You can't do it by yourself. To greet people differently. Did you notice that? How do you greet people? Are you always just talking to your friends, or do you go to even your enemies and greet them? Change the rules. Flip the script. When God gives sun and rain to people, he does so regularly. It's life-giving and it's generous. Could you be that way with your enemies? Regularly be generous and life-giving to them. But Let me illustrate with Luke 6, 27, 28, the verses that my son quoted to me. I can sing that song word for word, by the way, these days. Love. To love is to cultivate a new heart attitude. God, change my heart. Give me the feelings. I don't have them. Just be honest. I don't have them. I've got other ones I don't want to name. Give me love. Do good. An actual action where you, I don't know, bake them cookies. Send them a gift card. Shovel their snow this winter. I don't know what it is. You actually do an act of love for them. And then bless. Bless is spoken. Bless is how you speak to them and about them. And it's wishing them God's best. And then pray. Pray that God would change your heart and eventually theirs and certainly the relationship. And I got to tell you, you got to do it more than once. I've driven by that house hundreds of times since. Every time I go down that street, I remember that incident. In the early years, I would practice this. I'd pray for them. I think they've long since moved. But you got to do it again and again. Consider when you have a file on your computer. You got a file and you hit delete. Does the file go away? Our computer nerds are going to kick in here. The file name and sort of the file structure disappears. But you know what? All the ones and zeros that were left, they're still there on your computer. You can recover them pretty quickly, actually. That's a lot like these hard feelings. It's easy to say, okay, I'm done with that. I prayed once. I gave it to God. And all of a sudden, we find the feelings coming back. You recover it, can't you? You can recover it when you want to. The only way for that file to disappear is when you write over it again and again and again and again with a new file. And again, and all those ones and zeros get jumbled, and it's no longer recoverable. Again and again, we have to love our enemies until finally we love our enemies. Imagine that. And all those feelings are gone. It's writing with Christ's blood over top of that bad blood that you have with someone. So our story was titled The Perfect Christmas. Not because it went perfectly or I acted perfectly, certainly not. It's because I learned about God's perfect plan from a six-year-old of how to love people I don't want to. The first time I went back and encountered those people, I had no plan and it could have gone very badly. The second time I was going back there, I was making a plan, and it was not a good plan. This is hard stuff. But Jesus has taught us his plan, and that's in the face of hatred and opposition and maybe persecution and being taken advantage of. Love beyond reason. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you have called us up to where you are. We were enemies. We were your enemies. And you loved us into the family. Lord God, it's easy to just accept your grace and sing about your amazing grace. But Lord, in that song, we want to appreciate your amazing grace so that we can give it out to other people as well. That they can experience it, not just from you, but that they can experience it from us, your followers. Lord God, we need your help. This is hard stuff. But it's transformative to the world and to our relationships. So give us the power and strength, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow. Can we say thanks to Scott for that amazing message? That was challenging, especially when you said, you know, animosity. Because sometimes, you know, animosity builds up in family. You know, it's like, oh, is my wife my enemy? When, you know, I got to be careful and be quick to diffuse that. That's powerful. It is time for next steps. At Genesis, we think it's one thing to just, you know, hear this Sunday morning, hear from Scripture. It's another thing to actually live it out in our week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And we want to give you some really tangible, really clear next steps on how you can actually act on this lesson in your week to come. And the first next step is a conversation. A conversation that you can have even this afternoon as you're going to get lunch with your family, going to get lunch with friends. If you're at a small group at Genesis, ask your small group this question in this week to come. But the question and the conversation we want you to have is, do I love people like Jesus does? Or do I just love people regularly? Do I love people with more love than what's expected? Do I love them unreasonably? And that can be a convicting and a challenging question to ask, especially to people who know you really well, right? Because they know when that maybe isn't the case, and they can point that out to you and gently correct you in that. So the first next step is a conversation. Do I love in an unreasonable way? And number two, our next one is a next step of selection. We want you to select maybe some people or a person in your life where maybe there is some animosity, maybe there is some opposition. And we want you to choose a real tangible, real clear way to love them in this week to come. Maybe you pray for them. Maybe you pray for your own heart and say, God, change my feelings towards this person in this week to come. Maybe you bless them some way. Maybe it's you take them out to lunch and you get to know them a little bit better. I feel like sometimes, you know, proximity leads to empathy. So if I'm looking at somebody and I'm judging them, maybe I just need to get closer to them and meet them where they're at a little bit more. But we want you to take that step. Identify the person and then take that step in this week to come. Raise your hand if you think that you can take on these next steps this week. Yeah. We want you to live out. Don't just hear the word, but do it as well. That's where next steps come in. That's what we want you to do with this week to come. Let's pray real quick once again, and then I'm going to give you guys a couple dismissing notes, and we'll all go home. Dear God, thank you so much for today. Thank you that you kept the rain away and brought out some sunshine for us today, God. It is a blessing to be able to meet in this place. And gather all together, all of us as Genesis Church. We're grateful for it. We pray for those who couldn't make it today. We pray that they're blessed by this message as it goes out this afternoon on our Facebook and YouTube page. We pray for the people that we're going to meet in our week to come, those people that, they're challenging to love. We pray that you give us power to love them in an unreasonable way, in a way that transcends, goes beyond what's reasonable in our own heads, that we might enter into the love that you have loved us with. While we were yet sinners, you died for us, and you loved us, and you cared for us. We're so thankful for that, Lord. We're thankful for that message that we've heard today. Let's live it out in this week to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, Genesis Church, again, if you're new, we have a welcome table in the back. If you want prayer today, if you want to be prayed over, see that tree? That's our prayer tree for today. So we're going to have people there who can pray for you today. Right now, after service, if you want to go there and receive prayer, go to the prayer tree. It's the one on the right. And we also have a gift box in the back if you want to supply us with a gift. Thank you so much for coming today, Genesis Church, and we will see you here next week as well.